word so that we might not stay the same after reading it. God, use your spirit to lead us as we explore your letter to the Galatians. Just give us hearts to hear and let us be changed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Well, it's really good to be back. So some of you I know have asked questions, so I'm going to quickly tell you what's going on. I have acute end-stage degenerative disc disease and acute osteoarthritis in an acute flare-up. The flare-up was not cute at all. So, but I have, the flare-up is, today my doctor said, wow, what are you doing? And I said, praying. He said, keep praying. So thank you all for your prayers. I'm so grateful. And I'm also so grateful that Karen Woodall is part of Ladies Cornerstone Ministry. And what a blessing. And so I got to watch it more than once. I love it when you watch it on YouTube because you can rewind. And so I rewound and rewound and rewound and took hundreds of words worth of notes, and thank you so much, Karen. So, last summer, J-Mo and I spent time in San Diego. We went to visit my son Noah and our daughter-in-law Lauren, but most importantly, I thought we should start the day, and he's praying for surf. Theodore George Oliver, affectionately known as Teddy, we also call him Theodorable. Anyway, in July, J-Mo and I attended a Sunday service at a small church in San Diego of only about 30,000 members. And we were surprised and blessed to hear the pastor that day that was sharing had been a pastor on staff at the church where I got saved in 1984, Mickey Stoney. It was such a blessing. Of course, we didn't get to talk to him, but it was really a blessing. So Mickey tells this story of a missionary couple who had served and came back home, and they ended up getting a job with an elderly woman taking care of her dogs. Well, as some time went by, the elderly woman passed away, and she left all of her wealth, and she was wealthy, to, wait for it, her dogs.
Oh, God.
And so I did a little search on Google to see if I could find her story, and what I found were a whole bunch of stories of these wealthy people that bequeath their wealth to their pets. And I found the 10 biggest inheritances ever left to pets. And the tagline of that said, once a novelty, it's now become expected for the unimaginably wealthy to leave millions to their surviving pets to ensure there's no disruption in their spa treatments and fancy feasts. So, and then Mickey said this, the truth is, sometimes we live just like those clueless dogs. We have no idea how truly wealthy we are. Last time you were all together, Karen closed with these thoughts. Like I said, I love rewind. There is freedom in facing the hopelessness of your humanity. And she went on to say, that means your flesh will always fail. That means it's not up to you. Living the Christian life is not up to you, but it is living dependent on the Spirit of God within you. These are quotes. You can get off the treadmill of trying to earn your way to God's favor, and you can't do it. Our righteousness is as filthy rags to him. Your flesh will fail every single time, but, big but, she said, if you are a believer, you already have the favor of God. At your worst times, at your best times. The standard to get God's favor has been met for you in Christ. You have the promise. It's not up to you. It never was. That is the joyful message of Galatians chapter 3. You have everything you need. You don't have to work for it. It was given to you as a gift in Christ. And tonight, we will focus on the fact that as his children, through faith, he has placed us in line to receive all that he has for his children through his grace that works to bequeath our inheritance. Now this word bequeath, it means to give or leave by will, to give by testament. It was God's predestined will that he would graciously give us and leave by his will, a inheritance. In Ephesians 1, we read, also we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to his purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will. Last week, Karen also reminded us of the great lengths that Paul went to in order to explain the purpose of the law. Great job. Great job. Remember, the purpose of the law was to reveal our complete and utter inability to live by God's holy standard of perfection. And it was intended to awaken us to the reality of our need for a Savior. But through the new birth, praise God, we are no longer judged by the law. Good news. Christ took the judgment of our sin. And more than that, he made us sons of God, which makes us heirs, not by the law, but according to the promise, as you studied last week in Galatians 3. Now that faith has come, we're no longer under a tutor, for you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's descendants, heirs according to the promise. And that's where we pick up tonight. But the foolish Galatians had fallen prey to the lies of legalism. Listen to Warren Wiersbe says about legalism. One of the tragedies of legalism is that it gives the appearance of spiritual maturity. The Judaizers had bewitched the Galatians into thinking the law would make them better Christians. Their old nature felt an attraction to the law because the law enabled them to do things and measure external results. Yeah, we've already acknowledged that doing things can make us feel good, and it can feed our need for self-worth. But let's think about this. If you're a parent, I am, and if you're not a parent, you're at least somebody's child. So a question, by what external measures do we parents use to determine that our children belong to us? Granted, most families have specific standards in their household rules like curfews, chores, church attendance, weekly family obligations, etc. And while we fully desire our children and we expect them to adhere to our family's code of behavior, we don't say, our family eats dinner every Friday night. And because my kids come to dinner Friday night, they've proven themselves to be my children. How preposterous is that line of thinking? But what if my kids really did think that? If I don't come to dinner Friday night, if I don't clean my room, if I don't whatever mom put on them, then my mom will disown me. Then every decision my kids made would be based, not because they belong to me, but out of fear of being abandoned and dropped from the family. Remember what Paul wrote to the church in Rome. For all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. For you have not received a spirit of slavery, leading to fear again, but you have received a spirit of adoption as sons, by which we cry out, Abba, Father, Daddy. The Spirit himself testifies that with our spirit that we are children of God. It is his grace that works to lead us out of a fear-based relationship into faith by the unchanging and sure assurance of his Holy Spirit. I went too fast, sorry. Sorry, I did not have a slide there. Okay, the assurance that those who have been born again have been adopted into his family. We have been received a spirit of adoption. Those whom he adopts are brought into an intimate relationship with him as their father, Abba, to be his children forever. Because even if my kids never ever adhered to my family code of behavior, and even if they lived in adamant opposition to it, I could never disown them, even in my imperfect love. Mm-hmm. Nothing would change the fact that they belong to me. But even for those who have disowned their children, they can never undo the reality that through birth, that child was in fact born their child. When we are born again through faith in Jesus Christ, how much more can we rest in the perfect love of God, demonstrated in the giving of his perfect son that secured our place in his family forever? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him over for us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things? Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword or an acute flare-up? For I am convinced that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor things present nor things to come nor powers nor height nor depth nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Everything is created except God. And every promise in his word is ours through our inheritance, an inheritance that is secure in him because it is his grace that works to bequeath our inheritance. It's really amazing to think about. So amazing that sometimes we struggle with believing it's really ours, at least in the here and the now. Because let's be honest, sometimes our spiritual wealth gets overshadowed by the tangible, the stuff we can see and touch with our physical senses. And like those beloved puppies of that rich old lady, we really don't have a clue how wealthy we really are. And now this is where Paul turns our attention. Believers, when you place your faith in Christ, you become a descendant of Abraham, the blessed believer, and you are placed in line for the inheritance as an heir of God. This word inheritance, that which a person is entitled to inherit by law or testament. Remember, his grace that works is not contrary to the law, but it is only his grace, by his grace, that we're made fit as those that are entitled to receive his promised inheritance, as Paul emphatically stated in Galatians 3:21, is the law then contrary to the promises of God? May it never be, for if a law had been given which was able to impart life, righteousness would indeed have been based on the law. Now, we know there are biological attributes that are handed down from ancestor to their offspring. And it is his grace that works through the crucified life that passes along the hereditary attributes of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, as he lives his life through us, Galatians 2:20. And as Karen reminded us, is coming in further detail when we get to chapter 5. Paul is going to painstakingly remind the Galatians of this amazing grace gift as he elaborates on the inheritance God has chosen to bequeath upon his children. It was his grace that works to bequeath our inheritance in his time. Galatians 4:1 and 2. Now I say, as long as the heir is a child, he does not differ at all from a slave, although he is owner of everything, but he's under guardians and managers until the date set by the father. The Jeremiah Study Bible points this out. In the context of the day, despite his position as an heir, a child was as a slave with no rights in the household until the father decided it was time for that child to enter into the rights of his inheritance. And Paul goes on. So also, while we were children, we were held in bondage under the elemental things of the world. Paul points out that the law functioned as a guardian and manager for God's people until the appointed time determined by God the Father. But when the fullness of time came, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. God's timing so often doesn't line up with our own, right? Think about things you're waiting for, answers to prayer that have not happened. And sometimes we just think, if God really wanted to get it right, he would take our advice as far as when things should happen. But as Ecclesiastes 3 says, there is an appointed time for everything, and there is a time for every event under heaven. And who is doing the appointing? Not us. While While preparing this particular lesson, I happened to be reading through Deuteronomy, a book that is all about the law, all about obeying his statutes, commandments, ordinances, and precepts, all 613 of them. But it's also a book that points to God's sovereignty in determining the timing of all history. Repeatedly, you will read things like this in Deuteronomy. Then it shall be when you enter the land which the Lord your God gives you as an inheritance, and you possess it and live in it. God was determining the when. He appoints the time for everything. The time of creation, the time of calling at Abraham, the time of Isaac's birth, of sending Jacob's son Joseph into Egypt to spare the many, of his deliverance of his people out of slavery, of their entrance into the promised land, of the appointment of the kings, of the Jews' captivity and exile, of their return to the promised land, of the prophets who warned and foretold of the coming Messiah. God appointed the time. And he appointed the time when he would send his son. And he appoints the time of our adoption. Because when the fullness of time came, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, so that he might redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. He redeemed us. He bought us back out of the slavery of sin, out of the prison of the law, for the express purpose of adopting us as his sons. And being a son comes with personal and legal rights. And the Galatians knew all about that. And Paul wrote, because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. It is his grace that works to bequeath our inheritance through his gift of adoption. The coming of Christ freed believers from the bondage of slavery, from the bondage of sin, to be able to enjoy unfettered relationship with the Father as his children, and to receive our spiritual inheritance as his mature sons and daughters. According to Mike Mazzalongo of Bible Talk, he wrote, as many as two-thirds of the Roman Empire were slaves during this time, but this number decreased rapidly in the first century and continued falling as Christian ideals began to take hold in the pagan society. So the Galatians were all too familiar with the reality of slavery, and it's quite probable that up to two-thirds of them were slaves. When someone bought a slave, the buyer then could do whatever he wanted to do with that slave. He could own it and use the slave however he saw fit, or he could set the slave free. But God goes so far beyond simply setting us free from slavery. His grace that works does the unimaginable, the inconceivable, and adopts us as his son. Ellicott, Commentary for English Readers, said, redemption is followed by adoption. The admission of the believer into the messianic kingdom with its immunities from sin and from the law implies an admission into the messianic family of which God is the Father and Christ the eldest son, the firstborn amongst many brethren. It is his grace that works to redeem us from our sins, to release us from the penalty we deserve as lawbreakers, to grant us admission into his family, and to bequeath our inheritance. When? While we were enslaved to the gods of this world. And Paul wrote, however, at that time, when you did not know God, you were slaves to those which by nature are no gods. And we can understand Paul's exasperation. How could his beloved Galatians even consider going backwards to the law to serve false man-made gods? For they had come to the one true God who had revealed his very nature, his divine nature, through his son. And then Paul says, but now that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God, how is it that you turn back again to the weak and worthless elemental things to which you desire to be enslaved all over again. This phrase, elementary principles, elementary things, comes from a Greek word that signifies a row or a list of items. The word was also used of the letters of the alphabet. Paul was stressing that the law really treats people as infants, teaching the basics of what to eat, what to wear, where to go. Legalism does not grow a believer, but produces spiritual immaturity and leaves God's children in bondage. Paul warned the Colossian believers to be on their guard of this very same trap. See to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deception, according to the tradition of men, according to the elementary principles of the world, rather than according to Christ. And of course, Paul cannot help but wonder, how are you allowing yourselves to be taken captive by the ABCs of the world rather than Christ? How can you go backwards into spiritual infancy and immaturity? And worse, how could you ever trade your freedom as a child of God to become enslaved to the deceptions and futility of the elementary principles of the world? Because in Christ, we have all we need, as he went on to write in Colossians, for in him all the fullness of deity dwells in bodily form, and in him you have been made complete, and he is the head over all rule and authority. In Christ, we are made complete. The law is not the ultimate authority over the child of God. It is in Christ. He is our authority. And so we must ask ourselves, are we going to start living like slaves again? Paul told the Galatians, you observe days and months and seasons and years. And Paul was referring to some of those ancestral traditions of certain festival days that required certain sacrifices and certain offerings. And as Karen pointed out last week, these ordinances were deeply ingrained in everything they did. But it was a system of fear. If I don't do this, then God won't be happy. What kind of things do we do? Perhaps set up as ceremonial observances that must be adhered to. If we have a conviction from God, that's one thing. But too often we act like the Judaizers that insist the real Christian has to listen to this kind of music, wear these kind of clothes to church, avoid these kind of people. There's a bunch of them. JMO and I have two kids. They both are ours. I birthed them both, but they couldn't be any more different. But by the grace of God, I don't insist that Noah has to act like Sarah or Sarah has to act like Noah in order to stay my kid. Now, we have family rules established by our family as the governing authority, not by those outside of our family. When my children were young, and after asking permission to partake in some activity and unhappy with their parents' decision, they often retorted, so-and-so gets to, to which their dad and I would always reply, what's your last name? They knew immediately what that meant. It didn't matter at all what so-and-so was allowed to do. Our family followed our family's rules and ways, not so-and-so's. It was an effective method to halt their argument. There simply was no denying who they were. Let's let Christ be our authority, not adherence to someone else's rules, not others' opinions, and definitely not the weak and worthless elemental principles of the world. Because when we start adopting the world's views and ways, that is real cause for fear. This kind of behavior should instill fear in us, fear for our well-being, our growth, our sanctification. And Paul felt this. He felt good cause for fear. And he wrote, I fear for you that perhaps I've labored over you in vain. And a walk down memory lane is in order. Paul says, I beg you, brethren, become as I am, for I've also become as you are. You've done me no wrong. What Paul is saying is, hey, I got rid of all the Jewish traditions. I became like you. I just fellowshiped with you. Become like me and get rid of all that stuff. And then 13, he says, but you know that it was because of bodily illness that I preached the gospel to you the first time. Paul found himself in Galatia due to some bodily illness. Perhaps he contracted something in the region, or perhaps he needed to make a detour in order to get medicinal attention. Remember when Paul asked the Lord to remove his affliction? Not once, but three times in 2 Corinthians 12, 7-9. And God's response was a call to trust his all-sufficient grace. Many wonder what Paul's affliction was. He did call it a thorn in the flesh, so it seems possible that it was a physical condition. And in the letter to Galatia, he refers to his bodily condition. He says, and that which was a trial to you in my bodily condition, you did not despise or loathe, but you received me as an angel of God, as Christ Jesus himself. Where then is that sense of blessing you had? For I bear you witness that if possible, you would have plucked out your eyes and given them to me. Now, some scholars speculate that Paul may have contracted malaria. Others, based on what he wrote here in Galatians, believe he had some grievous eye infection that caused him to be physically repulsive. But it's also possible that when Paul talked of the Galatians being willing to pluck out their eyes, he was simply saying that they would have done any and everything for him. So the fact is, we really don't know what his bodily condition was. And if God really wanted us to know, he would have told us. But because of his illness and his labor, the Galatians have heard the gospel and received Paul as a messenger from heaven who spoke truth. There was obviously a true love relationship between the Galatians and Paul. They had received Paul in love when he brought them the truth of the gospel, and now Paul wonders, had he become their enemy because he still brought the truth? As he wrote, so have I become your enemy by telling you the truth? Sometimes truth is hard to hear, and sometimes the best love is tough love. Later, Paul will be even more aggressive in his condemnation against the Judaizers. But mamas, what would you do if someone was leading your child into danger? Into a place where fear and anxiety were the primary forces at work, instilling in them constant worry if they were loved, whether they were doing enough to continue to remain a part of your family and be called your children. And really, this is where the Judaizers were leading the Galatians. A life fraught with concern over doing enough. Because justification by the works of the law will only lead to a life of stressing and fretting. And we know what that leads to. Do not fret. It only leads to evil doing. Stressing and fretting is evil, as it is the very antithesis of faith. And a bit of the mama bear comes out from Paul against the Judaizers. For beyond their instilling fear in the Galatian believers, Paul points out the insidious motivation behind the Judaizers' work amongst the Galatians. They eagerly seek you, not commendably, but they wish to shut you out so that you will seek them. This phrase, eagerly seek, in the Greek is actually one word, and it comes from the root word for zealous or jealous. These Judaizers were zealous in their pursuit of the Galatians, but it was not with commendable or noble intent. These Judaizers were engaged in a very cult-like behavior, like an exclusive club calling the Galatians to cut ties with others and to look only to them as their source of authority. Danger. If we ever come across anyone that claims to have the inside track on the Holy Spirit, run. Cults engage in that kind of manipulation, much more concerned with separating themselves by their list of do's and don'ts than leading their followers into a relationship of love, both for God and for others. Consider what Paul wrote to Timothy. But the Spirit explicitly says, in the latter times, some will fall away from the faith, paying attention to deceitful spirits and doctrines of demons by means of the hypocrisy of liars, searing their own conscience as with a branding iron. Men who forbid marriage and advocate abstaining from foods which God has created to be gratefully shared in by those who believe and know the truth. While we are not Paul, and we were not taken up into the third heavens to be taught the gospel, we have been provided the revelation of Jesus Christ, and it is not according to me. All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, training in righteousness. I heard this verse explained this way. All scripture is profitable for teaching us what is right, what is wrong, how to get it right, how to keep it right. So that the man of God may be adequately equipped for every good work. God has given us all we need in his holy word to be known and believed. And nothing is to be taken away or added to it. We must always examine everything we hear according to this book. His word is meant to transform us inwardly. His word will produce genuine zeal, not mustered up for outer displays. And after Paul calls out the motives of the Judaizers, he challenges the outer zeal that the Galatians display. But it is good always to be commendably, to be eagerly sought in a commendable manner, and not only when I am present with you. The Galatians had been bewitched, more concerned with an outward exhibition of zeal than the inward reality of his grace that works through our adoption to conform us to the reality of his resemblance. Barnes points this out. Probably they relied much on their zeal. Perhaps they maintained, as errorists do, and deceivers are very apt to do, that zeal was sufficient evidence for the goodness of their cause, and that persons who are so very zealous could not possibly be bad men. But zeal without knowledge will definitely lead to poor judgment and ultimately to sin, as Proverbs says. Even zeal is not good without knowledge, and the one who acts hastily sins. Paul is calling their zeal into question. They had been zealous for him and the gospel message he had brought, but in his absence, they had turned away from the gospel of grace, bewitched and mesmerized by the zeal of the Judaizers. Paul understood the zeal of the Judaizers. According to his own words, Paul out-zealed them all in his zeal for the law. Remember what he wrote in chapter 1? I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my contemporaries among my countrymen, being more extremely zealous for my ancestral traditions. But Paul had brought them the only true gospel. And more than anything, Paul desires that they remain zealous for the truth, whether he is with them or not. Barnes further notes, true zeal or love will live a life when the object is near and when it is removed. When our friends are present with us and when they leave us. When their eye is upon us and when it is turned away. God's eye is ever upon us. And he has provided all those who are adopted into his family the assurance of his grace that works to bequeath our inheritance. But we have to ask, are we living with our eye always upon him? For what are we the most zealous for? Is it possible we've been mesmerized by the zeal of others more than by his holy word? Tonight I need to wrap up with something that is very heavy on your heart. And I need to share with you what may step on some toes. But I pray you hear my heart. It is only my desire that if any toes are stepped on, that this would lead to a straight-footed walk. So I humbly ask that you prayerfully listen and ask the Lord to reveal his truth on this subject. There is an extremely popular devotion series that many are zealous for, but I'm afraid it is zeal without knowledge. So again, before I go on, I ask you to prayerfully listen. And if you are attached to this devotion, don't take my word for it. Please do your own investigation. It was around 2012 when a friend gave me this devotion, and that they loved, and I began reading it, and the devotion immediately evoked my emotions. But by about the third day of reading, I had to ask, who is this person who writes as though she is Jesus talking? So I did some research on the author, and yes, I'm talking about Sarah Young, author of the widely popular Jesus Calling series. And what I discovered was beyond troubling and very concerning. And for any of you who are interested to read more than what I'm going to share tonight, I do have a handout for you, and it includes from what I'm sharing. But for the sake of time, we are going to only consider four of the most egregious concerns that Pastor Challies addressed in his article entitled 10 Serious Problems with Jesus Calling. I also am going to include an excerpt from Kathy Keller, Tim Keller's wife, who wrote a review on the book in 2012, and an incredible quote by Charles Haddon Spurgeon 167 years ago. I ask you all to consider what Paul said in chapter 1. If it's a different gospel, it is no gospel at all. Jesus Calling was first released in 2004, and by last count has sold more than 25 million copies, with no signs of slowing down. But as Tim Challies states in his article, 10 Serious Problems with Jesus Calling, yet it is a deeply troubling book. His article describes these 10 serious problems, and then he says, in the hope that you will consider and heed these warnings. Like I said, we only have time to consider four, and it is in the hope that you will consider and heed these warnings. The first problem, she speaks for God. This is all in the handout. Far and away, the most troubling aspect of the book is its very premise, that Sarah Young hears from Jesus and then dutifully brings his message to her readers. There is no way to avoid her claim that she's communicating divine revelation, a claim that raises a host of questions and concerns, not the least of which is the doctrine of Scripture alone, which assures us that the Bible and the Bible alone is sufficient to guide us in all matters of faith and practice. She is not writing to help you understand the Bible. Instead, she claims to be writing down the words that God gives her in times of being in his presence. She considers these to be God's words to her, and she is passing them on to you. Second, she proclaims the insufficiency of the Bible. Jesus Calling only exists because Sarah Young had a deep desire to hear from God outside of the Bible. Sarah needed more from God than he gave her in the Bible. Quote from Sarah, I began to wonder if I could receive messages during my times of communing with God. I had been writing in prayer journals for years, but that was one-way communication. I did all the talking. I knew that God communicated with me through the Bible, but I yearned for more. That's her words. Increasingly, I wanted to hear what God had to say to me personally on a given day. In those few sentences, Challies wrote, she sets up an unnecessary competition between her revelation and what we are told of the Bible in 2 Timothy 3:16, 17. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be completely equipped for every good work. Biblically, there is no category for what she provides as the heart and soul of her book. Biblically, there is no need for it and no reason we should expect or heed it. Thirdly, her deepest experience of God comes through a practice God does not endorse. Young does not only endorse her practice of listening, but goes so far as to elevate it as the chief spiritual discipline. This practice of listening to God has increased my intimacy with him more than any other spiritual discipline. So I want to share some of the messages I have received. In many parts of the world, Christians seem to be searching for a deeper experience of Jesus' presence and peace. The messages that follow address that felt need. Notice that her solution to addressing the desire for Jesus' presence and peace In early versions of Jesus Calling, Young tells of her discovery of the book God Calling and the way she modeled her practice of listening on it. She describes it as, quote, a devotional book written by two anonymous listeners, end quote. These women practice while waiting quietly in God's presence, pencils and paper in hand, recording the messages they received from him. She goes on to say, this little paperback became a treasure to me. It dovetailed remarkably well with my longing to live in Jesus' presence. Challis says, it is worth noting that recent versions of Jesus Calling have been scrubbed of this information. God Calling is an equally troubling book that saw much success beginning in the 1930s and has seen a revival of interest in the wake of Jesus Calling. It is at times sub-biblical and at other times patently unbiblical. And yet it is a book she regards as a treasure and a model for her own work. And from a review on Jesus Calling by Kathy Keller, written in 2012, she wrote, the great Bible teacher James Montgomery Boyce, late pastor of 10th Presbyterian Church and author of many books about the Bible, wrote that the great issue of our day would not be the authority of the Bible, but its sufficiency. Would we trust it to be all that we need for life and godliness, or would Christians turn to other revelation and experiences? Jesus Calling represents just that trend. Young had the Bible, but found it insufficient. And Keller goes on to say, the only place we can be sure we are hearing God's word is in God's word, which is about the word of God, Jesus. The Holy Spirit will illumine verses from his word so that we are taught, rebuked, corrected, and trained in righteousness so that we can find salvation in faith in Jesus Christ. But the Holy Spirit never promised he would deliver new revelation to non-apostles, no matter how sincerely they waited and listened. And as Charles Haddon Spurgeon so eloquently stated more than 160 years ago, I have heard many fanatical persons say the Holy Spirit revealed this and that to them. Now that is very generally revealed nonsense. The Holy Ghost does not reveal anything fresh now. He brings old things to our remembrance. Jesus said, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to remembrance, whatsoever I have told you. Let us pray that because we have received his grace that works to bequeath our inheritance, an inheritance revealed in his holy, God-breathed word, that we would grow in our zeal for his word that is according to the true knowledge of his gospel, as Peter wrote, seeing that his divine power has granted to us everything pertaining to life and godliness through the true knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and excellence. We pray with you. Heavenly Father, we humbly bow before you, and we thank you that you have given us all we need in your word. And I pray, God, for areas in each of our lives that are being distracted, zealously sought after, God, to steal our hearts away from the truth. Father, whatever was not of you tonight, I pray you would just remove it from the hearer's ears, God. Any work that you desire to do, Lord, would we so humbly respond. You are good and you are faithful to give us your word. We're just so blessed that we have access to your peace and your presence daily, every day, as we come to you and seek you in your God-breathed word. Lord, we love you and we thank you for this precious teaching of Galatians to remind us that we're yours forever, that our inheritance is sure in Jesus Christ. Oh, how we love you.